On Thursday of this week, our nation will consume approximately 60 million turkeys because it is Thanksgiving. It is officially the beginning of the Christmas season, is how we see it. It is the beginning of the greatest financial exchange of our entire year. But, you know, somewhere in our national memory, that we have a memory of an image. It's an image of a people that are in black, that are generally in the snow, that are with muskets. Somewhere in there is a feast. Somewhere in there are Indians. There's a big ship that came from England. But with most of us, we have a lot of gaps as to who these people were. What I'd like to do this morning, something I've never done in 40 years of ministry, it's a good time to do it. I'd like to tell you the story of the first Thanksgiving, the story of the first fathers. It begins in the year 1600 in a small village in England named Austerfield. And there was a village church there named St. Helena's. It was built in the 11th century. And above the church door was a representation chiseled in stone of a serpent with its mouth gaping open, which was puzzling to all as to its meaning. But on this day in 1600, a 12-year-old boy gazed at it and felt that it meant that the Anglican church that met there was indeed the devil's instrument. The young boy was an orphan who had recently been bedridden because of a mysterious illness, and his concerns had become spiritual, even at 12, concerned with the state of his soul. He was discontented with the Church of England, and he was looking for a new church. There was a small group that had begun meeting a short distance away in a village called Scrooby, in an old manor house occupied by the postmaster. His name was William Brewster. He was a former aide to an English diplomat. And the group that met there was considered dangerous. They were a group that was religiously banned by the Church of England. Politically, they were banned by King James I. They were the radical fringe of the Puritans, who were themselves considered dangerous in England. But these people wanted not to purify the Anglican Church, as did the Puritans, or even to exist with a hierarchy of bishops. They were called separatist, and they felt that the local congregation alone was free, and the local congregation alone was authoritative and subject to no one but Christ. And thus they separated from the Church of England, hence their name, the Separatist. And this group, within 20 years, would move from Scrooby, England, to Holland, and then from Holland to America. And they would be renamed by the grown-up orphan boy, whose name was William Bradford, as Pilgrims. The boy would grow into a young man who would serve as their leader, and he would serve as their second governor. And he was the one who would document their progress in his journal, a journal that is still today our greatest source on who these people were. They never grew as a church beyond 300. They would plant a church in America with just 50 of their own, and with 52 more who came with them from England, known as strangers, many of whom would die in the first few months they were here. Their dream would die in just 70 years. And this group, however, would rank with Jerusalem and Antioch, with Ephesus and Rome, as the most significant churches in history. And this is the story of that church and of those people. We call them the Pilgrims, the Protestant beachhead in the New World, who brought the best of the Reformation to the shores of America. The first of thousands of Puritans who would follow after them to establish what was called the American Classic Christian Consciousness, the Christian worldview that set the course of this country until the mid-19th century. These were the original Americans. These Puritan separatists met in Scrooby, England, under the direction of a minister named John Robinson. What did they believe? Well, they were first Protestants. Their final authority was the Bible alone. Not church authority, but the Bible. Not tradition, but the Bible. Thus, they did not kneel during communion, as the 12 did not. They did not make the sign of the cross, as the 12 did not. Nor would their preachers wear vestments, as the 12 did not. And they also were separatist. They did not acknowledge the hierarchy of bishops, because the New Testament did not. It spoke of elders, and it spoke of Christ above them. They also were Puritans, because they believed that there was a covenant between them and God to obey and God to save. They were not just to claim the name of Christians. And with each other, they were to corporately maintain God's law, and they were to live together in constant devotion, in covenant devotion. They were as much a clan as they were a church, as much Amish as they were Puritan. And they were strict Calvinists in their theology, stressing man's depravity and the complete sovereign act and freedom of God to choose, to save, to convert, and to keep his elect. They were saved by grace through faith alone. They believed that true salvation was followed by rebirth, necessarily experiential faith that had to be proven to be a church member. Their church service focused on the explanation of Scripture and the New Testament, not so much communion. Sabbath, their Sunday, was strictly observed as the church, they felt, was the new Israel. All work was forbidden as all pleasures. Moral holiness was to pervade every area of human existence. The name Puritan was given by their detractors. And they felt all Christians were priests, and all Christians were to master the Scriptures. Thus, for these people, literacy was as vital to them as holiness. And they felt the church role was to be pure. They were not to be true believers among a role of many false believers. They were to be free of nominal Christians, and they practiced church discipline. And most importantly, they felt that their purpose was redemptive. They and their faith, they felt, was the hope of mankind. As Catholicism attempted in Rome, as Calvin attempted in Geneva, as the Anglicans attempted in England, these people felt they would succeed in a government that was ruled completely by the saints of God. They felt that the previous attempts had failed, as state and church were not totally obedient. They, however, in a new world away from compromised government and compromised Christians, would succeed. This was the flame, the vision, the dream, and as we would call it later, the manifest destiny that preserved these people in all weathers. They felt they were God's city set on a hill. They came to this country not merely for religious freedom. They came for their religious freedom, to establish a theocracy, a rule of God through the saints, a new Israel. This was not a group of religious pluralists, but religious dogmatists. How did they arise in England? They were Puritans that split away. Queen Elizabeth's religious, what was called via media, or the middle way, also called the Elizabethan settlement, was an Anglican theological attempt at compromise between Protestants and Catholics to keep everyone happy and content. But there arose the Puritans who sought to purify or to reform within Anglicanism. The separatists saw England as the city of destruction and Anglicanism as Babylon. Come out from their midst and be separate, said Isaiah. And they did. They did not stay within the church to purify it. They withdrew from the Church of England. And at this same time, Fox's Book of Martyrs, detailing the deaths of the English faithful at the hands of the Catholic Bloody Mary, was on every Protestant's nightstand saying that there is a time that an Englishman must die for what he believes. The church from Scrooby saw themselves not in the tradition of the Via Media, but in the uncompromising tradition of Fox's Book of Martyrs. James I, who succeeded Elizabeth as king, was more vehement against the Puritans than even Elizabeth. He said, "If they do not want a bishop, they will not want a king. I will harry them out of England." The separatists of Scrooby now existed in violation of civil and of church law. They knew it was a matter of time before their secret meetings were found out. It happened in 1607. The Anglican Bishop of York became aware of the secret meetings at Brewster's house. Members of the congregation began to be followed to their homes. Some were arrested and thrown in prison. It was time to leave England. But there was no legal way to do so, as one needed governmental permission to cross the English Channel for the continent. The separatists of Scrooby would have to leave secretly. And it was a fearful prospect for these farmers and artisans, most who had never left Yorkshire. Even more for a now 17-year-old William Bradford, who stood to lose his family inheritance, which awaited him at the age of 21. But with Pastor John Robinson and Elder William Brewster, he made plans to depart to the more tolerant Holland. The English captain who was first hired to transport them betrayed them to English authorities. The church's leaders were thrown in prison for months. Upon their release, they tried again with a Dutch captain. But the authorities were on the lookout, and as the church was boarding the ship, the English authorities showed up with the militia. Only a portion of the men of the church had boarded, with no women or children. But the Dutch captain, fearful of capture, launched for Amsterdam, Holland, leaving the men's families weeping on the dock. It was several months before they were reunited. Once in Amsterdam, they were delighted to find other English separatist congregations who also had left. But there were problems. With no church hierarchy, there was no authority, and there were no doctrinal restraints, and some separatist pastors had adopted controversial positions which created quarrels and schisms among the churches. The Scrooby congregation, now among like believers, found themselves not in unity, but in dispute. To find peace, they moved further away to the neighboring city of Leyden. Their pastor, John Robinson, bought a house in Leyden, and in the garden behind the house, he created a miniature village of a dozen houses. Half of his congregation lived communally in these houses, and it was known simply as De Grain Pert, the Green Lane. Their ideal of Christian fellowship for the rest of their lives. It was the happiest moment of their church existence. Much of American Christian heritage began in a backyard in Leyden, Holland. And it was in Leyden that a now 21-year-old William Bradford took a wife, Dorothy, and then 4 years later had a son, John. But Leyden had its drawbacks. Leyden was a city of 40,000, a commercial center whose inhabitants worked from dawn until dusk, 6 days a week, a bell announcing when work began and ended. No longer did they work in the green hills of England, but in what England called the vomit of the ocean. Industrial, tolerant, capitalistic, mercantile, grimy Holland, diked against the threatening sea. Their children were losing their English heritage, and they were adopting the more loose ways of the tolerant Dutch. The separatists of Scrooby decided to move and to start all over again. But where to move? Where to have freedom and yet seclusion? North America had become the focus of France, of Spain, of Holland, and of England since the 1500s. England, though, did not have the finances to fund a broad-based colonization, as did France and Spain and Holland. And thus, two English groups of noblemen, private businessmen, one in London and one in Plymouth, took advantage of the demand, and they supplied the capital for migratory groups to go to America and to colonize. But one group was lost in Roanoke, another had failed in Spain. The Jamestown colony in Virginia was less than a success. as the groups went searching for wealth. So the plan was to provide patents for colonists to begin what was called plantations, permanent farming communities. After 5 to 7 years of labor, they would have paid for the patent, and that would give them permanent title to the land to colonize their future. The problem was that these were mostly farmers dealing with London businessmen. The only person with business smarts, Elder William Brewster, was in hiding. He had established a printing press in Leyden and printed tracts against the English king and bishops. King James ordered his arrest, and when agents came to Holland, Brewster went into hiding. By June of 1619, Deacon John Carver and congregant Robert Cushman had secured a patent, but did not know how they would finance the journey to the New World. And so William Bradford so believed in their calling that he sold his house, the house he had bought with the money of his inheritance. The church, or rather the Dutch, had plans of their own to settle the New World. When they heard of the English plan, they sought to block them. And so the pilgrims of Leyden threw all of their trust on what was called the Merchant Adventurers of London to provide the patent to settle the mouth of the Hudson River in northern Virginia, 200 miles north of Jamestown. Prime real estate. The pilgrims were intended to become New York. But as 1620 approached, two-thirds of the congregation decided to stay to let the initial group bear the first brunt of the settlement and then to join them later. Pastor Robinson would stay in Leyden, and Elder Brewster would go with the 125 others to the Hudson River. But before they left, the merchant adventurers changed the name or the terms of the contract. Instead of working 4 days for the company with 2 days for themselves, they were to work 6 days for the company. And worse, their representative, Robert Cushman, had agreed to the terms without consulting the rest in the church. Pastor Robinson and the pilgrims vehemently objected. And worse, a sailing vessel had not been procured by the company. But the group had to leave quickly to arrive at the Hudson before winter set in. So while the company sought a vessel, the congregation purchased one of their own to help transport them to explore the coast, to fish, and if need be, to return to England. But worse still, the merchant adventurers insisted on what we would say fully booking their flight and adding to the numbers some 52 non-separatists from London, completely unknown to the pilgrims. And thus their covenantal union was violated with what they called strangers. And worse still, one of the strangers was hired by the merchant adventurers to be a purchasing agent for the trip, one Christopher Martin, who refused to cooperate with Cushman and Carver and proved extremely difficult, said, "Cushman, we are readier to dispute than to set forward a voyage." The pilgrims bought a ship called the Speedwell. The captain, a Mr. Reynolds, said that he and his crew would stay for 1 year in America. The Speedwell left from Delfshaven, a port in Holland, to Southampton in England to meet with whatever ship the merchant adventurers had hired, and Pastor Robinson knelt on the deck of the Speedwell with his departing congregants. And Bradford wrote with watery cheeks, commended them with most fervent prayers to the Lord and his blessing. In Southampton, England, the separatists got their first view of their contracted transport, 100 feet in length, three times the size of the Speedwell, with three levels, the Mayflower, waited in port with her captain, a 50-year-old Christopher Jones, who had taken the Mayflower to Norway and Greenland and across the channel numerous times transporting wine, the aroma of which made the Mayflower what was called a sweet ship. The pilots were named Robert Coppin, who had been to America earlier, and John Clark, who had delivered cattle to Jamestown. Along with them were between 20 and 30 sailors. Military matters would when arriving, would be handled by an English mercenary chosen over Captain John Smith. His name was Miles Standish. And so in Southampton, England, the laden congregation met up with their families and friends from England who had boarded previously in London and would continue with them to America. And there, to their joy, was Elder William Brewster, who had come out of hiding in England to head west with his flock, and they rejoiced. And there were the strangers, recruited by the adventurers to take the place of the congregation who chose not to go, amounting to 5 additional families. One of interest was named Samuel Hopkins, who 11 years earlier had sailed on the English ship Sea Venture for Virginia, only to be wrecked in Bermuda. A shipwreck that became the inspiration for a new English playwright named William Shakespeare. And that play was called The Tempest. Things came to a head with their investors as the Ladeners refused to honor the contract signed by Robert Cushman. The directors of the adventurers stormed off in a huff, saying they could stand on their own legs. They would provide them no funds for the journey. The pilgrims did not have enough food to last the first year. So food had to be sold from the Mayflower to make the trip. And worse, the Mayflower's governor, Christopher Martin, appointed by the adventurers, hated the pilgrims and took every chance to insult them. Wrote Cushman, "If we make a plantation, God works a miracle." And worse, 70 of the 125 chose not to go. Only 50 were left. Still worse, when the two ships left Southampton, the Speedwell began to leak like the dikes of Holland. And after only 75 miles out, they put back in at Dartmouth for repairs. It was now August. Summer was getting away. Worse still, Mr. Cushman in Dartmouth had a heart attack, and he stayed behind. "I pray," he wrote, "that you prepare for evil tidings every day." They finally made repairs and made it off the tip of England, and 200 miles out, the Speedwell sprung another leak, and they returned to England. It was now September. They gave up on the Speedwell and put in at Plymouth to crowd as many passengers as possible on the one ship, the Mayflower, and to go on alone. Robert Cushman stayed behind and died 5 years later. Now 102 people crammed on 100 feet of ship. It was discovered later that Captain Reynolds had sabotaged the Speedwell, purposely causing the leaks by replacing the two masts with larger masts. And when sails were full, the masts were too strong for the smaller ship's hull. The boards of the ship separated under the strain of full sail, and the water poured in. Once Reynolds gave up the ship and the pilgrims went on, Reynolds replaced the mast, resumed his nautical endeavors, fattened on the price of a ship that never sailed. Then westerly gales began to howl across the Atlantic. The month of delays had eroded their supplies. The cooped-up passengers were in no shape to travel on. Captain Jones could have canceled the voyage, but on September the 6th, 1620, he set out from Plymouth, heading to Virginia, now to arrive in the dead of winter. Months earlier, the congregation of 300 had dreamed of all of them by themselves in the summer, sailing tucked away along with their own ship on a pleasant voyage with pastors and elders into the mouth of the Hudson River, just north of their Jamestown countrymen. A city set on a hill, the light of a new day to dawn on the new world, evil left behind. How bright it looked. Now, just 50, a sixth of their number, mixed with strangers, ruled by Christopher Martin, a lout. Away from pastor and loved ones and country, food diminishing, broke, duped, deceived. Led by an elder and a former 12-year-old orphan adopted by the church, crammed in the midsection of a 100-foot ship with a 5-foot ceiling. Like rabbits in a warren, 102 in all, with two dogs, a spaniel and a mastiff. Was this of God? They must have asked 1,000 times. We don't know much of that two-month voyage. William Bradford's account only gives us two paragraphs. There was seasickness, which was mocked by one particular sailor who said he would like to toss half of the pilgrims overboard. He was the first to die. It pleased God, wrote Bradford, to strike this young man with a grievous disease, the first to be thrown overboard. All his fellows noted this to be the hand of God. Bucking gales and a hither unknown, what was called Gulf Stream, the Mayflower traveled at 2 miles per hour. The rising winter had blown them far north of the Hudson, but no one knew how far. The trip had taken a month longer than planned. Scurvy was beginning to set in among the pilgrims. They needed to reach land as quickly as possible. So the pilot steered a straight westerly route to a well-known English fishing spot known as Cape Cod, which reached out into the sea, beckoning like an outstretched arm. Seagulls appeared. The water changed from blue to pale green of an approaching shore. And on November the 9th, 1620, after 65 days at sea, the pilgrims saw land. Bradford wrote that the pilgrims were, quote, not a little joyful. But though it was land, it was not the sight of the Hudson River. It was not the sight of their patent. That was 220 miles south, but time and health were of the essence. But the wind was from the north. In a couple of days, they could be at the mouth of the Hudson. And so south it was. But the problem was there were no maps on the land between the Cape or the Hudson. No way of knowing the hazards. They proceeded down the coast with Master Jones high in the crow's nest, continually taking soundings, seeking to know the water's depth. The pilgrims had now come to the deck and were watching the autumn scenery glide by in a rare time of refreshment, until 1 p.m. Then the Mayflower encountered what was called the meanest stretch of shoal on the American coast. It is called today Pollock's Rip. The tidal waters rushing in, then out amidst sandbars creates a saw-like effect that is dangerous even today. By 4:30 that day, the ship was heading back to Cape Cod. By 5 o'clock, the sun was setting, the sailing was now dangerous. So they anchored off the coast of present-day Chatham, and they waited for daybreak. And that night, trouble began to brew on the ship that was solved by the conceiving of one of the most important documents in American history. Had the pilgrims put in at the Hudson, they would have been on English territory under English law. Cape Cod was not English. So who would rule it? The pilgrims? The thought of this put the strangers in a turmoil. They would not be ruled by religious radicals. But rule had to be ensured. Thus, the establishment of a civil constitution, a contract by which they were all bound. It was called the Mayflower Compact. Only the men signed, as was the custom of the time. They must have debated about submitting to the military discipline of Miles Standish. So instead, law for the common community was established based upon the character of God. And it worked. A run-on sentence, it simply read, having undertaken for the glory of God and the advancements of the Christian faith, the honor of our king and country, a voyage to plant the first colony in the northern parts of Virginia, do by these presents solemnly and mutually in the presence of God and one another, covenant and combine ourselves together into a civil body politic. For our better ordering and preservation and furtherance of the ends aforesaid, and by virtue hereof to enact, constitute, frame such just and equal laws, ordinances, acts, constitutions, and offices, from time to time as shall be thought most meet and convenient for the general good of the colony, unto which we promise all due submission and obedience. A constitutional government, based on divine character, submitted to and agreed upon by all, to be amended as needed, its big brother would arrive in 150 years. The next morning, the ship was guided into Provincetown Harbor. It was November the 11th. Their home was 3,000 miles away. English Jamestown was 500 miles south. The merchant adventurers would give no help. Captain Jones was ready to be rid of them and to return to England. The land before them was low and sandy and cold and forbidding, and Indians were believed of such legendary ferocity that they could skin a man alive with the shell of a clam, and they were out there somewhere. But it was finally time to go ashore. The Mayflower carried a smaller ship's boat that could carry 16 men, and when they had set foot on the sand, wrote William Bradford, quote, "They fell on their knees and blessed the God of heaven. They wandered over the dunes and found stands of trees and loaded their boat with fresh-cut red cedar. And that night, the pilgrims, strangers and sailors on the Mayflower's deck, sat around a warm fire, but everybody wondered the same thing. Where are the Indians?" The fact was, they were gone. 15 years earlier, a French explorer, Samuel de Champlain, had drawn a map of the area, and one sees a thriving Indian village. Now it was vacant, because 7 years earlier, from 1613 to 1619, plague brought by English fishermen swept the region. The Poconoket tribe who inhabited the region was reduced from 12,000 with 3,000 warriors to a force of a few hundred. Being winter, the tribe moved inland 65 miles west. Had the pilgrims arrived years earlier, they would have been repulsed or destroyed. Months earlier, in summer, they would have been in danger. But this year, at this season, allowed them the freedom to disembark. And the plague also created a favorable situation. Though the Poconoket were diminished, their major enemies had not been affected. Thus, the Narragansetts had reduced the Poconokets and their great chief, or sachem Massasoit, to subservience. And thus, Massasoit sought allies from the surrounding peoples of the Massachusetts, the Naussets of Cape Cod, to bond with him as allies. The incoming English, well known by 1620 to the Indians, as a strange and formidable people, were now looked upon as possible allies, especially since they brought, as the Indians understood, the plague, the first weapon of mass destruction. Though things looked chaotic, irregular pieces began to fit. Two other eerie occurrences preceded the pilgrims' arrival, one from a French prisoner of war, the other from an Indian slave. 6 years earlier, Captain John Smith had come south from Jamestown exploring the Cape Cod coast. One of the commanders of his vessels was a man named Thomas Hunt, who seized as many of the natives as possible to sell them as slaves back in Spain. His actions, said Smith, damaged the English-native relationship for years to come. 1 year later, in 1616, 4 years before the pilgrims' arrival, a French ship wrecked off the shore. The Indians did to the French, as indeed Hunt had done to them. They killed all the survivors but a few, and they made them slaves, taking them from village to village and making sport of them. One of the Frenchmen was of a religious bend. He had learned enough of the English language to warn them that God would destroy them for their wickedness and would give their land to others. The Indian chief assembled all his people about him on a hill with the French captive beside him and demanded if his God was, quote, big enough to kill all of these. The Frenchman responded that he surely was. And within 3 years, plague vacated the area. The other eerie thing came from an Indian slave. In 1619, 1 year before their arrival, another English explorer named Thomas Dermer sailed down from Maine with an Indian guide who was one of those who had been abducted by Thomas Hunt 5 years earlier. His name was Tisquantum. He had spent 5 years as a slave in Spain, in England, and in Newfoundland. He now made his way back, and being bilingual, he found a new career as a guide to Englishmen, particularly to Thomas Dermer. Thomas Dermer returned to England and left Tisquantum on Martha's Vineyard. When Thomas Dermer returned to the region in the spring, he found the Indians strangely, rabidly anti-English. Because that spring, an English ship arrived at Narragansett Bay, invited Massasoit's people, the Poconokets, on board, and then shot them down in cold blood. When Thomas Dermer arrived back from Virginia, he and his men, all of them, were summarily executed. Tisquantum's people had mostly died of plague. With Dermer now dead, Tisquantum was a free agent. With a little assertiveness, he could be the sachem, the chief of the remnant of his people. Tisquantum assumed the shorter name Squanto for good reason. In the belief of the Poconokets, there were 38 gods. The last was one that assumed the form of a snake. He was the spirit of the dark who appeared at night. He could heal or he could cast a curse. He was to be feared. He was called Tisquantum, or shortened to Squanto. In assuming this name, Squanto claimed an intimate relationship to what the English would know as the devil. He was thus to be feared. But as he had been a guide to the English, Squanto was still distrusted by Massasoit and was kept by him as a prisoner. When the Mayflower arrived in November, it was assumed by the Poconokets that these English had come to avenge the attack on Dermer. So Massasoit watched them from afar, needing their alliance, fearing their motives, fearing the plague they may have brought. Squanto's unique ability was becoming more important with each passing day, and so he waited his chance. A mediator with the natives was now providentially prepared and needed. Meanwhile, on the Mayflower, it was time to explore and find a settlement. They lay tucked under the great hand of the Cape in what would be called Provincetown Harbor. But having no maps, they had no sense of where they were situated. The next day was Sunday. There was no work, only a church service. Their first act in the New World was worship under the guidance of Elder William Brewster. On Monday, those healthy enough made their way to a freshwater pond for clothes washing, beginning a tradition in New England of Monday being wash day. And they had their first home-cooked meal of blue mussels that were abundant on the rocks, leading to shellfish poisoning that led to church-wide vomiting and diarrhea. And these farmers also beheld in fascination their first sight of whales, pilot whales sporting off the shore. 16 men once again boarded the ship's boat to move down the coast looking for a river to put in. They were led by Captain Miles Standish, who in Leyden was chosen over Captain John Smith of Jamestown fame because of the fear of Smith's swashbuckling, assertive personality. The stranger John Smith, the pilgrims felt, might seek to rule them. Smith scorned their choice, saying that such fanatics must be beaten with their own rod. And so they set forth, led by their 5'5" red-headed mercenary, whom they dubbed Captain Shrimp. They marched down the coast looking for a river there on the Cape whereby to dock, when they spotted six men and a dog coming toward them on the beach. Was it Captain Jones? The six men quickly ran into the woods and then whistled for the dog. It was Indians, their first sighting. They followed them all day trying to make contact, but they were no match for the Indians. They came back to the shoreline to spend another night in the cold. The next day they found cornfields and a burial mound and the burned remains of a recent small English fort, probably Thomas Dermer's. They indeed were not the first to arrive. And somebody did not want English here. And then they came to a hill whose sand had been padded smooth. They dug down to find a storage of corn. They took the corn with reluctance, intending to recompense them, a prophetic beginning between Native Americans and white men. The hill was named Corn Hill. They returned to the Mayflower, leaving some beads in exchange. And a few days later, a larger ship's boat, this time carrying 34 men. They spent the night in freezing cold. The next morning, they had 6 inches of snow. Today, it is aptly called Cold Harbor. And as they trekked, they found that this stretch of land was not large enough for a building site. They returned to Cornhill for more corn, and then half the group returned to the ship. The rest, some 17 men, set forth. They found another burial mound with the blonde remains of a French sailor. They indeed were not the first to arrive. Then they found a wigwam, an Indian dwelling. They took the best things, then they returned to the ship. In 3 days, they had raided a grave, a food bin, and a home, not an auspicious beginning for those coming for the service of God. Once they returned to the ship, they decided to look down toward the mainland. And so they would make the 25-mile trip around the bay. And on December 6th, they set forth. The mist froze on their clothing like a glaze. They looked for a site. They slept with a guard. And they awoke at 5 a.m. The air suddenly was filled with war cries, the shrill, mocking laughter of Indians laughing at their enemies' hopeless estate. Then the air was filled with the arrows of 30 warriors. If they had ever wondered of the skill of the natives, now they found out. Each warrior carrying approximately 50 arrows, firing 5 at a time, each 3 feet long, many pointed with eagle's talons. The pilgrims huddled behind their boat and fired their muskets. Amazingly, none were injured. The beach today is called First Encounter. That day, they sailed the southern edge of the bay, and as night approached, the wind changed and increased, and freezing rain began. The waves rose and broke the ship's rudder, and then broke the ship's mast. Men grabbed oars to right the ship as it was cast onto a beach, and as the sun arose on Saturday, they found they were on the main island off the mainland. The Mayflower's pilot, named John Clark, was piloting the ship's boat, and he was first to set foot on what is now called Clark's Island. They were a short distance from the shore of the mainland in what would be named Plymouth, but it was Sunday now. That day the men rested, and again they worshiped, and on Monday they explored their new home. They named it Plymouth to identify them as the group of separatists who had left from Plymouth, England. They were not just Englishmen. They were separatists, coming not for wealth, but coming for the worship of God. They sounded the harbor's depth. It could handle the Mayflower. They ventured on land, and the shore of Plymouth is sandy like Cape Cod, except for a high hill at the base of which was a 200-ton granite boulder. Looming, one author wrote, like a recumbent elephant. Bradford wrote nothing of the rock, but it would seem to be the natural place for landing. Nonetheless, it became the place of legend, Plymouth Rock. Marching across Plymouth, they found brooks and cornfields but no Indians. This was the place. The next day, they headed for the Mayflower with the good news. On December the 12th, they approached the ship with their boat with the news. Wrote Bradford that after a month of exploration, they had, quote, found the promised land. But as they approached the ship, it was strangely silent. Because Dorothy Bradford, 5 days earlier, William Bradford's wife, had fallen off the ship into the frigid water and drowned. How does one fall off the ship, off the deck of a ship in harbor? The mystery of the pilgrims will always be to this day whether Dorothy Bradford, surrounded by death, facing the dead of winter, her 3-year-old son still in Leyden, had leapt to her death. The one William Bradford called his dearest consort was gone. She had made it all but one step. On December the 15th, the Mayflower anchored 1.5 miles from Plymouth Rock, as close as the beach would allow. After 3 more days of exploration, the building site was settled upon. A 165-foot hill rose near the rock. A stream was beside it. On a clear day, Cape Cod could be seen 30 miles away. The place would be called Plymouth Plantation. The area had already been cleared by the almost 2,000 natives who had lived there. But disease had so vacated the area that skulls and bones were found everywhere lying above the ground. The pilgrims saw it in the light of Joshua's conquest of the promised land, the removing of the Canaanites. That night, 20 men remained on the hill as the remaining would disembark and unload. On December the 21st, they planned to begin building, but a storm hit with gale force winds. On the storm-tossed ship, 2 men that night died of scurvy and a fever. A woman gave birth to a stillborn son. The Mayflower had become a hospital ship. A prayer must have gone up so close to their dream. Carest thou not that we perish? On Saturday, December the 23rd, a work party left the ship to build a common house on shore for all who would then begin their own houses. Sunday, December the 24th, was a Sabbath. Again, they worshiped. On the 25th, Christmas Day, 1620, the frame of the first house went up. The same day, in a sense, that Jesus took up residence in a new home. Christmas celebration, there was none at all, because Christmas Day in Europe was more akin to Mardi Gras, and the Puritans considered it profane. They worked on Christmas Day, rejecting England's frivolity, and toward sunset, the cries of Indians erupted from the surrounding forest. They were being watched by those who did not want them to be there. 2 weeks later, a common house was erected, walls of hewn trees with mortar of clay and twigs, like a rural English cottage. Wooden platforms on the hill went up for 6 cannons. Miles Standish planned the city as a military installation. 19 houses would go up on 2 intersecting streets. Never had the Green Lane of Holland been a fortress. They worked quickly as the Mayflower was planning to return to England. But on January the 11th, William Bradford was, quote, vehemently taken with grief and pain. He collapsed to be taken to the common house. The weight of leadership had taken its toll, and their leader went down. Only 6 were healthy enough to care for the others. By the end of January, all goods had been moved from the Mayflower. In February, Indian fires began to be seen, twinkling in the night about them, watching. So Standish began to organize the men into military order. 2 people a day began to die. 3 families were completely wiped out. 5 families had left 1 remaining orphan. 4 men had become widowers. Only 1 widow had survived the winter. By spring, of the 102 that arrived, 52 would be dead. More than half would not survive the winter. The thought arose, if the Indians about us are waiting us out, when we shrink enough, they will attack. The memory of Walter Raleigh's lost colony of Roanoke was very close. They began to bury their dead by secret, so well that the remains of the Pilgrims were not discovered for 100 years, and that through the runoff of a storm. In mid-February, the Indians began to show themselves and then leave, possibly because of the 6 8-foot half-ton cannons that could fire 3-inch cannonballs for a mile. The village was taking on the look of a fortress. In March, birds began to sing most pleasantly, wrote Bradford. On March the 16th, as the men met to discuss military matters, the meeting was interrupted as a single Indian appeared, then approached without fear or hesitation, passing the watching women and children, and walked straight into the common house meeting. The entrance was barred by a man with a musket. The Indian appeared delighted with all the fuss he had stirred, and then pronounced the now famous words, "Welcome, Englishmen." The English were speechless. None of these had ever seen up close an Indian. He was nothing like they had ever seen. He was markedly taller than all, with long black hair, short in front, long in back, face and body hair hairless. Stark naked, but for a leather strap about his waist, armed with a bow and 2 arrows, one with a pointed tip, one without, the message being obvious. He brought peace, or he brought war. They offered him a coat, and then food and drink, and then he requested a beer, which he openly enjoyed, beginning an American tradition. He introduced himself as Samoset. He was a chief, a sachem from a tribe in Maine. He had learned English from English fishermen whom he had befriended, and he informed the Pilgrims that the harbor's name where they were was Patuxet. The tribe that lived there had died of plague. The chief of the region was Massasoit. The tribe was the Poconokets, who lived 40 miles southwest during the winter at Narragansett Bay. The tribe of Cape Cod, where they had landed 5 months earlier, were called the Naussets, who felt ill toward them for their theft of their corn and that English had kidnapped and enslaved them years earlier. He also spoke of another Indian who had lived in England as a slave named Squanto, who spoke English, he said, better than he, and he was among the Poconokets, and Massasoit requested an audience. He would leave and bring Massasoit and Squanto that they might speak. All winter, Massasoit had watched these Englishmen. They weren't there to trap, and they weren't there to fish. There were families. They came to settle. He had never seen English women. He had never seen English men with children. He had had bad experience with the English, but Squanto had persuaded him that they could be mighty allies if he, Squanto, could make contact. Massasoit was not sure he could trust this one who had been so friendly with the English. Over the winter, Massasoit had assembled all the region's shamans and what were called powwows. We would call shamans today medicine men or maybe witch doctors. They gathered in a swamp, the place where it was believed the spirits resided, to cast spells upon the English. But a shaman to the north, considered the mightiest among the tribes, said that no magic would work among the English, and he urged all of the natives to stay far away from them. But Squanto said the English had cannons and muskets, and most of all, they had the plague. If allies, the enemies of the Massasoit would be subdued. Reluctantly, Massasoit agreed. He would gamble on the advice of a cultural mongrel 5 days after the initial visit, Samoset returned with four Indians, and among them Squanto, who spoke to the pilgrims about the section of London where he had lived and answered all their questions about Madrid and their questions about Newfoundland and their questions about the New World. Soon, Massasoit appeared in full dress with 60 armed, painted warriors. Massasoit met with a representative of the pilgrims named Edward Winslow. They ate and drank together, and then Massasoit began to sweat profusely and tremble in fear because Squanto told him the English kept the plague in barrels in a shed. The fact was, it was gunpowder, and the Indian king was more than willing to make a treaty. And after 5 months now, the pilgrims had found a peaceful, trusting relationship to one of the mightiest men of the land, one providentially prepared, in a seeming providentially prepared place, at a providentially prepared time, with a providentially prepared interpreter. That night, a meal was held to cement their treaty. The Poconoket's dark spirit, named Squanto, was thought to inhabit snakes and eels. Accordingly, Squanto, who had mediated the treaty, prepared a covenant feast of eels, said by the pilgrims to be plump and sweet. 2 weeks later, on April the 5th, the Mayflower headed home. The voyage had been a disaster. Captain Christopher Jones had lost 18 men from his crew, and the one who stayed behind, a barrel maker named John Alden, who became the first hero of Longfellow's The Courtship of Miles Standish. Speak for thyself, John Alden. The Mayflower arrived back in London with Captain Jones and his remaining crew in only 1 month, half the time of the initial crossing. 2 years later, Captain Jones was dead. The Mayflower was anchored in the Thames River at London and sold by his wife for scrap for 128 pounds. Squanto stayed with the pilgrims that spring and gave them a crash course in native gardening. The ground at Plymouth, he said, was so poor it had to be fertilized with dead herring. And that spring, the seed the pilgrims had stolen did well. Their own peas and barley struggled. In April, the pilgrims' governor, John Carver, became ill, then lapsed into a coma and died. His replacement was the church's once 12-year-old orphan that had stared at a serpent in Austerfield, William Bradford. His wife was dead, his son back in Holland. Again, William Bradford was alone, the second governor of Plymouth. The pilgrims, they made peace with the Indians to the west as Massasoit had planned. They became reconciled with the Naussets to their east, from whom they had stolen corn. They would victor in a war with Massasoit's enemies, as demanded by their treaty. And yes, in the autumn of 1621, they celebrated a Thanksgiving harvest feast. A harvest festival as in England with over 100 Indians. They feasted upon duck and geese and five freshly killed deer brought by Massasoit and stews kindled in pots full of fresh vegetables and indeed wild turkeys. And they thanked God to be alive. Forks were not used in England, so they ate with their fingers. There were few chairs, most sat on the ground, more like a church-covered dish picnic. No pumpkin pies, no cranberries, not yet. And they would have had their first taste of the unique brilliance of a New England fall, unlike the drabness of New England, of England's fall. And there was a possibility that they divided up, yes, for a competitive game after the meal, perhaps those of the herds named Cowboys versus the Redskins. Massasoit became a great chief. He died at an old age. His strategy of alliance worked well. Squanto? Squanto later attempted to turn the Pilgrims against Massasoit in a coup so he could take over. But his plan failed. Massasoit demanded from William Bradford the head and the hands of Squanto. But Bradford simply could not. Squanto appeared to work his way back into Massasoit's good graces, but after the great chief died, Squanto mysteriously died also from a nosebleed that would not stop. It is believed that Massasoit's son, Alexander, had him poisoned. Yes, Squanto got whacked. The Pilgrims, their dream of a community ruled by God, their dream of a theocracy, to be a city set on a hill, their dream of church and state ruled by divine law, succeeding where Europe, Rome, Constantinople, and England had compromised and failed, their dream failed also. William Bradford's last years were spent wondering what went wrong. Where had he failed? He would not even date the years in his journal as AD, Anno Domini. Why? Their children did not carry on their zeal. Pastor Robinson never made it to Plymouth. They had no church leadership. The military manner of Bradford and Miles Standish wore thin. Seldom does a church have a former mercenary on staff to organize the church militia who marched to church armed, two abreast for Sunday worship. Divisiveness occurred as many of the colony missed the warmth of the old days of the Green Lane of Leyden and wished things could have been like they were in England, and they left for other colonies, including William Bradford's own son, John, who immigrated to the New World and then left Plymouth for Connecticut. Bradford could not even keep his own son. Their stringent attitudes, like disciplining the divisive with gun butt beatings, I don't know what the problem was, and running the gauntlet, earned disapproval. Their novel way of going to war with Indian tribes in preemptive strikes drew the censure of Pastor Robinson by letter. He said they were becoming more skilled at war than they were in the scriptures. Their failure of a communal system of agriculture, the people simply wouldn't work. And that was solved by each house having their own plot. Their separatism was saved by capitalism. They were simply outnumbered also by the tens of thousands of Puritans that followed that were, well, not as separate as them. And as the America to come clashed with the Pilgrims' contented spirituality, the American frontiersmen spurned the notion of a Christian covenantal community and a God-centered life and struck out on an ambitious individual quest for financial prosperity. Conquest and individualism and ambition looked west. This was the profile of the American. It was the frontiersman that became the image of the future American. The Pilgrims became a memory of our English past. And they simply made the theological mistake that righteousness and commitment could be passed on physically to their children by physical birth. Ironically, those with the highest view of Adam's sin had the contradictory highest view of natural moral ability and progeny. Neither could Christian devotion be legislated in a commonwealth community. The church was never commanded to be a political theocracy. There are things that belong to Caesar's. Neither is the hope of the church a church-led political kingdom on the earth. All such theories broke down within 70 years. Their post-millennial view simply failed. They were not the new Israel. However, these were the Christian Marines of North America, who brought a far richer biblical perspective than did the French to Canada, the Spanish to the South, or the Dutch to New York. They gave incentive to the thousands of English Puritans who followed on their heels. Puritans who brought the full expression of the best of Protestant thought, the best of the Reformation, and within short years to come, these Puritans would form Harvard and Yale to train Native American ministers. Though dissenters went to Rhode Island and Catholics to Maryland and Quakers to Pennsylvania, Anglicans to Virginia, and the Dutch Reformed to New York, these were the first seeking purely religious freedom. The free expression of their Reformation thought, these the ones creating the seed of the American Constitution. The Puritan dream of America as a city on a hill slowly became diluted and then discredited in the treatment of the Indians as a war erupted between Plymouth and the Indians that were led by Massasoit's own son, Philip, called King Philip's War. The majority of the Indians of New England were either killed or deported as slaves. And Philip's head, the son of Massasoit, was stuck on a pike on the Plymouth Chapel steeple. And then the Salem witch trials or the mania of 92 lent seeming positive proof of a fanaticism that was in keeping with Europe, not the new order of America. The Pilgrim idea was then seen as a threat to the new American vision of tolerance. But not until they had shaped the American Christian consciousness that would continue for over 300 years, that would set the direction of thought of America and influence us down to this very day. Plymouth was a Reformation theological Normandy, a Normandy in a new world. This tiny slice of English Puritanism would knowingly fail in a dream, but unknowingly succeed in a far greater unplanned scenario. These few, these 100 from England, these 50 from Scrooby. One would write later, "O beautiful for pilgrim feet, whose stern impassioned stress a thoroughfare for freedom beat across the wilderness. America, America, God mend thine every flaw and confirm thy soul in self-control and thy liberty in law." What passion, what steadfastness, what conviction, what courage, what vision, what determination, what suffering, what sacrifice, what faith. These were our brethren. These were our fathers. These were the pilgrims. And that was Thanksgiving. Would you pray with me? O God, as Hebrews said, remember those who led you and spoke the word of God to you. And considering the outcome of their faith or their lives, imitate their faith. We consider those who led us. Indeed, we have improved on their ship and we have improved on their fishing. We have improved on their building, but we have not improved on these people. These who were led by the fear of God. These who longed as their greatest vision to give something that would outlive them. Those that long to establish the rule and the justice and the kingdom of God in their day. Indeed, Lord, even to this day, our greatest accolade is that across our country, a few here and there are able to say, I was a descendant of one of these people. My ancestors were part of the Mayflower. These that England would not have, these that Holland could not keep, these we took into the breast of America And indeed did they flourish in Massachusetts Bay and all through what would become the United States. And so we remember our roots and we'll thank you. And we pray that this Thanksgiving, as we slice the pie, as we eat the turkey, as we settle down with family, that we could remember those in the cold who simply prayed that they could make it one more day. And we shall thank you through Christ our Lord. Amen.